And on the eighth day, God looked down on his planned paradise and said, I need a caretaker. So God made a farmer. God said, I need somebody willing to get up before dawn, milk cows, work all day in the fields, milk cows again, eat supper, then go to town and stay past midnight at a meeting of the school board. So God made a farmer. It had to be somebody who'd plow deep and straight and not cut corners. Somebody to seed, weed, feed, breed, and rake, and disc, and plow, and plant, and tie the fleece, and strain the milk. Somebody who'd bale a family together with the soft, strong bonds of sharing. Who would laugh and then sigh. And then reply with smiling eyes when his son says that he wants to spend his life doing what dad does. So God made a farmer.
A reminder, if you would, those who have cell phones, if you could take the time to shut those off, and you won't be embarrassed when it goes off. On the surface. Also, a little bit later in the service, there will be an opportunity for those of you who might like to share a thought or a memory. Right after Clint has his sharing, that will be the ideal time for us to do that. So this gives you some time to remember back. Let's pray. Father in God, we are thankful for this gathering. As it draws the family together, it draws friends together. To remind us of a man that is loved and honored. I ask God that healing would continue, and Father, would we recognize that this is a time of celebration for the life of John Randall. May our hearts and our minds be refreshed of who John is. In Christ's name I pray, amen. Set particularly that were so familiar with John, and that's who he was, Papa. John Randall, 90, of Richmond, Oregon, died at his home on Tuesday, December the 8th, 2020, with his family at his side. John Walter Randall was born September the 11th, 1930, in Weezer, Idaho, to Chester Lorenzo and Faye Elida Fraser Randall, the oldest of five children. He attended schools in Weezer, Idaho, and Richland, Oregon, and graduated from Eagle Valley High School in 1948. John married Dorothy Ellen Williams on September the 18th, 1949, here in Richland. And they moved to Halfway, and they farmed for 4 years there. Teresa was born in 1950, and Rocky was born in 1953. And they moved to Pondosa in 1953, where John worked at the sawmill until it closed in 1959. And Judy was born in 1957. The family moved to Richland, Oregon, and ranched there and in Sparta. And John was a member of the Pine Eagle School Board from 1969 to 1983. He also was on the School Budget Board and the ESB Board for Baker County. And he served on several agricultural boards in Baker County. John and Dorothy were Conservationists of the Year for Baker County in 1991. John enjoyed hunting and camping with the family and a good visit with friends or even strangers. John was proud of his family. And he loved them all, especially the little ones. His true love was his land and cattle. And he said that he never had to go to work. He liked the ranch life that much. John was an honest man and never knew a stranger. John had fond memories of moving from Idaho to Oregon in the fall of 1945. He was 15 years old. Everything was moved by automobile except the livestock, which was trailed from Weezer. This took 3 long days and nights. The chuck wagon, the horses, and the cattle were ferried across the Snake River from Menlo and then left overnight at the Forsey Ranch, arriving in Richmond late the next night. John is survived by his wife of 71 years, Dorothy, daughters Teresa Watson and Judith Arby Booker, son Rocky Randall, brothers Frank and Shirley Randall, Clinton and Glenda Randall, sister Ethelyn Bob Williams, grandchildren Sean Watson, Jason and Aaron Watson, Chad and Kara Del Curto, Rob and Brenda Del Curto, Rita and Tom Del Curto, Chester and Cressley Randall, and Corey and Cody Thacker. 5 step-grandchildren, 13 great-grandchildren, 15 step-great-grandchildren, and 7 step-great-grandchildren. There's a lot of poppers in that name. He was preceded in death by his parents, Chet and Faye Randall, and brother Wesley and his wife, Marilyn Randall, sisters-in-laws and their husbands, Isla and Lauren Graven, Lauren and Lorene and John Chandler, and granddaughter Janelle Latin and Del Curto. Clint has a wonderful sharing, I trust.
Can you hear me in the back? I'm like, okay, sounds good. Well, Dorothy, Mom, Nanny, Aunt, Grand asked me if I might speak today. I didn't think I was going to do this. About my brother's life. So many stories, which ones do I pick? You know, there's just a lot of them. It's hard to talk about someone you have loved your whole life without feeling some emotion. However, today is about John, Dad, Papa, Brother, Uncle, Friend, and how he impacted our lives. Since John lived to the age of 90, there isn't anyone here today who knew him for his whole life. Frank would win the prize for knowing him the longest, since he's just 2 years younger. Many of you have only known him during his middle or older years. He has always seemed like an old man to some of you. Since I was 14 years younger, I really can't remember much about John's life before he and Dorothy got married. I was 5, and in my mind they were old and mature adults. John was my hero. Dorothy, my coloring book buddy. I remember a few people saying, 19 and 50, he might be a little young to marry, but it did last 71 plus years. When John and Dorothy were first married, my parents seemed to be somewhat housebound and very old. Mom was in her mid-30s, and Dad was in her 40s, and they didn't go as much as I wanted. And I would try and convince them, John and Dorothy that I should be with them wherever they might be going. I liked being with younger adults. It seemed that they would do crazier and wilder things, which was more fun, and it did expand my education, probably sooner than necessary. Sometimes when young couples first marry, they adopt a puppy to practice their parenting skills. I think I was the puppy for the practice run the first year or so, until Teresa came along. It turned out for me, I felt loved and they did seem to enjoy having me around. By the time Judy joined the family, I was past the puppy stage. Teresa and Rocky were giving them a run for their money, and so my time with them diminished. Our family lived the first 15 years of John's life on a ranch near Weezer. The things I know about those first years of his life are stories that I've been told. Based on the stories, I think those years formed the foundation for the rest of his life. He told me when I was fairly young that if I could find the things I really like to do and make a living doing it, life would be much better. I think that John eventually was able to do just that with his own life. John was born in 1930, shortly after the beginning of the Great Depression. Being part of a young family with few resources, everyone had to help best they could for their age. Ranching was done without modern-day equipment. Most jobs were accomplished with hand tools and sometimes a team of horses. Milking cows was literally by hand. The time involved with projects took longer and were harder. Work days usually went from daylight to dark. There was no four-wheeler to jump on to go to irrigate or help with moving around with the cows. John, being the oldest, was expected to help with most jobs. He learned to be a hard worker. We did get a tractor to help in getting some jobs accomplished faster and easier shortly after John's 15th birthday. During his later years, he seemed to enjoy being out in the field, sitting on a tractor, working away. John was an athlete. At Weezer, he learned how to box. I'm not sure, maybe Frank knows, how many times he won or lost. He did have some matches here in the valley. Probably right here where this building is here is where the school was, is where he boxed. I remember watching him box one time, it was all. He was just too young. He played all the sports at Eagle Valley High. I remember some football games right here where the cars are parked. He was proficient at pole vaulting, and I can remember him doing that during his senior year spring track meet. Right over in the corner there, it's where the pole vault. I think John set a good example and was always encouraging to me. I remember the first time I drove our old 1940s pickup. It had been left up in the field above where Dorothy lives now. It was at the end of a hard day of work. The guys had been pitching and stacking lawn hay. Everyone was tired. No one really wanted to walk up to get it. Frank and Wes were already cooling off in the ditch behind the house. I thought I was being funny when I said, I could go get it. John told me, he said, go ahead. Then he said, you do know how to drive, don't you? I said, yes, I know how. I've watched you. But then I told him my concern. My feet won't reach the starter, the gas, or the clutch, or the brake. John said, that's not a problem. Just put it in low gear and push on the starter. It will start right up and you can drive it down here. Maybe he had second thoughts because he added, when you get close to the gate, just shut the key off. So away I went, and sure enough, it worked. It was my first experience of driving by myself. I think John was watching closely since I was only 5 years old. When John and Dorothy were first married, they lived in Branson halfway for 4 years. From there, they moved to Pondos, and he worked in the mill, moving and stacking lumber by hand. The job was not easy, and the lifting hard on his back. They normally worked a five-day week, often leaving weekends open to go to the mountains. A lot of times it was camping out with our sister Ethel's family, looking for mushrooms, picking huckleberries, or an occasional hike into one of our many lakes here in the Lowells or to the north. When John was younger, he liked to fish and hunt. Every year, opening day of fishing season, we would go over the ridge here to Daly Creek. I remember spending most of my time watching for snakes rather than fishing. Opening of deer season, the guys would go up, would be on smoke packs back here to the south. When I was 12, I got to go for the first time. Opening morning, John told me I could hunt with him. Probably what he meant was he drew the short straw. I had our old grandfather's .30-30 Winchester. We spread out and hunted uphill toward the top. I was on one side of the draw and John was on the other. When we got close to the top, I could see John ahead of me sitting, waiting, and watching. The draw was really brushy, but I decided to cross over to John's side. It was so thick, I had to crawl through part of the way. I didn't know it, but he was watching the deer that had decided to cross over to my side at the same time. We came together in the middle of the brush patch. When I saw the buck, I raised up and shot, and he turned and ran back in the direction he had been coming and fell down. I crawled on through and walked up to the buck. All I could see was a small patch of hair missing off his back. I walked towards John and I yelled, "I got it!" He yelled back, "No, you didn't!" I turned and sure enough, I saw the buck's tail end as he was running back into the brush. I looked up at John, he was sitting there laughing really hard. Later in the day, John put me on a stand on the other side of the mountain, and he went down and made a drive back towards me. Sure enough, he brought one up, and I got my first 4-point buck. John elk hunted several years with the family near China Camp. Frank had hunted there earlier and convinced the rest of the family it was the place to go. The terrain is steep and rugged. Eventually, John quit going, but Frank has continued hunting there with friends and family. Over time, certain places have gotten named. Anyone going now needs to know about Burford's Camp, the Lower Camp, the Pink Ridges, the High Middle and Low Passes, and the High Middle and Low Crossings. There is one special place where John once shot in his pool. And since then, it's always been known as John's Stand. When the mill closed, the family moved back to Richland and ranched. John worked at the sawmill in Halfway. Some of the time, he worked at nights and ranched during the day. He told me once he needed a good job to support the ranching we were doing. During 3 of those years, I was gone in the Army. When I got out, I remember talking with John one day about being lonely. Most of my friends had moved on, and all the girls I knew had gotten married. I told him I wasn't sure what I was going to do. Dad was about to retire. I told John I was pretty sure I didn't want to be a rancher the rest of my life. He said he really liked doing it, but it sure wasn't something most people would want to do. I told him I was getting old, so old. I wasn't sure if I could find anyone to marry. At that time, I was almost 23. All my brothers and sisters had been married a lot younger than I was. He told me I wasn't too old yet. He said, you know that little Saunders girl that spent a lot of time with Teresa? She's a really sweet gal, and she would make a great wife. You need to get down there and get to know her. And that's a separate story. And that advice ever worked out for me. When her parents retired, John and Dorothy bought the ranch and moved to where Dorothy is living now. It's been in the Randall family for almost 75 years, or over 75 years. They were able to expand by purchasing more land and cattle. They worked hard at improving the ground so it would produce more grass and cattle feed. I believe he got a great deal of satisfaction out of seeing the work he was doing make a difference. John and Dorothy were selected as Baker County Conversationists of the Year. It was a great team effort on both their parts. This is when I was sure John had succeeded in finding the job he'd like to get up and do every day. John contributed to this community by serving on various Baker County boards and the Pine Eagle School Board. Glenda remembers when John and Dorothy would be there chaperoning the high school dance, right here in this old building again, isn't there anymore. She and Teresa thought they were so old at the time, maybe early 30s. John loved his family. He was a private person and didn't like getting attention. He grew up in a family that for generations thought it was not macho for a man to show love with hugs and kisses. However, you would always feel loved when you showed up and he teased you about being the best-looking girl from wherever you lived. Or if you were a guy, you would hear some comment that made you feel good about yourself. He always liked to sit and visit and find out where you had been or what you had been doing. John wasn't a world traveler. He seemed to like being home more than being somewhere else. Glenda and I did manage to get them to visit us most places we have lived. Most often it was a pretty short stay because he would need to get home for some reason. Our brother Wes and Marilyn seemed to have better luck in getting them to go, and they did take several trips together. Going with Wes was always an adventure. It's been a few months since the inevitable happened. I never heard John talk much about spiritual things. I have heard him use some of the words out of context a few times. In later years, he would say, you always need to be ready because you never know when that big hand is going to reach down and grab you and take you away. I saw John a few days before that big hand. It came down and he seemed at peace with it. When visiting during the last few years as his body was failing, we would get ready to leave, and he would usually say, aren't you glad you got to see me? He was a really good brother, and I miss seeing him. Radio broadcaster Paul Harvey once delivered a speech titled, God Made a Farmer, at an FFA convention. Ethelyn, Glenda, and I all thought that he was talking about John. Following is a small portion of it, slightly modified. And on the eighth day, God looked down at his planned paradise and said, I need a caretaker, so God made a farmer. God said, I need someone to get up before dawn, milk the cows, work all day in the fields, and milk the cows again, eat supper, and then go to town and stay past midnight at the meeting of the school board. So God made a farmer. God said, I need somebody willing to sit up all night with a newborn calf and watch it die, and dry his eyes and say, maybe next year. I need somebody who can shape an axe handle from an old pine board, shoe a horse with a hunk of car tire, prepare a harness with hay wire, feed sacks, and shoe straps. who at planting time and harvest time will finish his 40-hour week by Tuesday noon, then painting from truck back, put in another 72 hours. So God made a farmer. It had to be somebody who would plow deep and straight and not cut corners, somebody to seed and weed and feed and breed and mow and rake and disc and plow and plant and fix the fence and strain them out. Somebody who would bail a family together with the soft, strong bonds of sharing, who would laugh and then sigh, and then reply with smiling eyes when his son says that he wants to spend his life doing what Dad does. So God made a farmer. Thank you.
Well, I'm sure that a lot of memories came to the surface. And so this would be an opportunity, if there's someone who might like to share a thought, a short line about their memory of John or Papa. Please. Yes, sir.
He was my uncle, probably my favorite. And at one time I was up doing something and asking him about how to plant corn and this and that. He was in the shop out there with a cutting board, cutting some metal, just like I told him about. He cut it, reached out, picked it up, and threw it like that. I said, "What's the matter, John? Is that hot?" "Oh, take long to look at it."
A couple of things that came to mind. Yes, sir.
Frank.
I knew my brother pretty well, probably better than anybody else in here. And when John was 10 years old, he could do more work than most hired men can, or I would say than any hired man can today. I've never seen a man that could work as hard as he did. All the neighbors tried to come and hire him when he was 10 years old and tried to team. And we used the Jackson Fork to put the hay up loose, and he could do more work than any man around. And we had a lot of fun as we grew up. He was probably one of the greatest brothers that you ever had. When he became a freshman in high school, he was trained by the featherweight champion of the world. He was a boxer there in Weezer, and he was a featherweight champion. And he was John's trainer for 1 year. And John became a scientific fighter. And I don't think there's any man in the country that could beat him. Bob Richardson up here, he was probably one of the top boxing men in this whole country here. And Bob said he's probably the best boxer that has ever been around, and he could have gone ahead and probably been a world champion if he had wanted to, but that wasn't his desire. He kind of wanted to learn to, at first he didn't like farming very well, but he grew into it pretty fast, and he worked hard to go to Pondosa when he was dry piling out there, and it would be zero, and he'd be working in his shirt sleeves and kicking the boards with his feet, and he said I can wear out a pair of shoes in 3 weeks, so. But I don't know of any man that's in this country that could do anything that John couldn't do, and he was probably one of the best brothers that I ever had. So, of course, we grew up through the Depression, and things were a little different. We need to go through another depression today and people can find out what it's all about. It was a lot different than what it is now. But as I say, we've had a great life and a lot of fun, and I'm still alive, and I hope I can be around for another 100 years to see how the rest of them go.
Someone else, please.
Gordon?
Yes.
So Uncle John, my freshman year in college, I brought a couple of friends with me, you know, to visit. They were very green around the years. And it was calving season. And so we'd come down and we'd seen the calves that were there, but he had one that was having some issues. So we were down at my grandparents, Frank and Shirley's, and he called and he said, "It's time, come down right now." Okay, we got in the car, we came down. He was going to pull this calf. He asked my two college friends, "Do you want to help?" And they said, "We'll watch." So he pulled that calf, and their eyes got about this big, and he said, "When it's your time, I'll come pull your first kid for you." Neither one of them have had children.
Dorothy spoke the other evening to me when I was there. She talked about a little saying that John used to say. And it had the title called, "It's Nice to Get Up in the Morning." And I hunted around and I found that. It was written by a man who was born in 1857, died in 77, and died in 1950. But it was a song, but the chorus is what she quoted to me. And the chorus goes like this. "Oh, it's nice to get up in the morning when the sun begins to shine at 4 or 5 or 6 o'clock in the good old summertime. But when the snow is snowing and it's murky overhead, it's nice, oh, it's nice to get up in the morning, but it's nicer to lie in bed." And so he may have quoted more of that at times, but it was quite interesting. I thought that was great. I remember when John would come into the store when I would work there at the feed store for a while. And I'd ask him, I'd say, "Well, John, how you doing?" "I'm about 30%. About 30%. And when I helped with Brother Wes's service, I caused quite a stir when I inadvertently used John's name instead of Wes's. I can guarantee, though, I had John's attention. And perhaps since that time, or maybe even before that, but when I would see him and say, "How are you doing?" "I'm still a step ahead of you." So he knew what was coming, but he was aware that I hadn't caught him yet. And so, John, I guess I can finally say I caught you. I'd like to read just a short verse to you of Scripture. It is from Psalms 139. And it speaks about the purpose of life. Verse 1 says, "O Lord, you search me and you know me." I say that because we, you that are here, you know John in a various variety of ways. But there's one who knew him better. And then I go to verse 16 in that particular chapter, and it says, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. John alluded to that fact, didn't he, when he said, in later years, you need to be ready. And then verse 23 and 24 of that chapter says this, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. And see if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. See where he came from and what he did and his life, and here we are today. Because you see, if you remember in John's life, there were occasions that were set aside to evaluate and to regroup. Because it was needed. And one of the things that made sense was in this same thought was he make this consideration. First, am I really happy and am I genuinely challenged and fulfilled in life? And I say that in John's work, where he was challenged, but he was genuinely fulfilled in what he did. And the second thing might be this, that in light of eternity, am I making a constant and consistent investment for God's glory and his cause? And the third thing is this, is the direction of my life taking me and leading me toward a satisfying and a meaningful future? There's a song that I was asked to read, because the words fit so well. It paints a good picture of John. You have that in your memoriam, if you care to follow. It's called Daddy's Hands. And you could change out that to Papa, just as easily.
Oh, that soul in the spirit of John Walter Randall. Not for us to judge, but we leave that for God through His Holy Scripture. And I say to the Lord, thank you, Lord, for sharing the life of John with us. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for the life of John. And Father, now as we take time to share together in a meal that honors John, Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I'm supposed to say something else, Tammy, and I forgot what it was. Yes. Thank you, everyone, for coming and sharing, for being here. And the meal starts here. And let's see if we can get the majority of the family to kind of hit that line first. And with that, and you first. You'd like to speak? Okay. Just a moment.
I would like to thank everyone who came today. I would like to thank everyone who came today and honored John's life, and thank Gordon for doing such a beautiful job, and Clint and Frank, everyone who had kind comments, and the only thing I regret is that he isn't here to be able to visit with all of you, because he'd love to visit. I did want to tell you, my grandson made the urn up here for John. Sean Watson made that. And I wish John could see it. He'd think, boy, he did a good job. The wildflowers, every year, I receive their bouquet of these yellows. I call them balsam or sunflowers. Every year he'd bring in that bouquet. It's the only flowers he ever did bring me, but he brought them every year. And I want to thank you again, all of you, and the Grange members for all they're doing. Thank you.
Daddy's hands were soft.